मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, नाउ द नेक्स्ट चैप्टर दैट इज द नेक्स्ट फंक्शन दैट इज टू बी परफॉर्म बाय एवरी मैनेजर दैट इज ऑर्गेनाइजिंग. सो इन दिस चैप्टर व्हाट फंक्शन इज टू बी परफॉर्म एंड व्हाट थिंग्स इज टू बी देयर दैट वी आर गोइंग टू बिफोर स्टार्टिंग इट फर्स्टली आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजिंग. इट मीन्स identifying and grouping the activities and bringing together the physical, financial and human resource sources for establishing for establishing most productive relation for the achievement of objective. For the achievement of objective is known as organizing. It means, firstly, in this function, identifying and grouping the activities and bringing together the physical, human and financial resource and establishing a productive relationship for the achievement of organizational goal is known as organizing. That is clear to everyone. In simple words, we can say that arrangement of all the goods, all the activities in the organization in an order way for optimum utilization of resources is known as organizing. Is to be considered as organizing. That is clear to everyone. Now, I am going to tell you the next topic, that is organizing process. In organizing process, what function, what steps to be performed in organizing process? First step, identification and division of work. The first function that is to be performed in organizing process start with, first of all, the work is divided into small units. The task is divided into small units, small jobs. Small units, small work. That is clear. And it is to be divided as per the plan, the work is divided, and the whole task. So instead of giving the whole task to the one person, so we will divide into different employees according to their skills and qualification. So because of that, there will be no duplication of work, and also there is no burden of work on one person. The work is divided into small units and it is called jobs. The division of work into small units is called jobs. So that is the first step that we have to perform in the identification and division of work. Next, departmentalization. Under this, that is the second step that every manager have to perform, and that After dividing the work, the similar and related job are grouped together and put under one department. Put under one department. As for the departmentalization or for grouping the activities by organization in different way. But there are only two common way by which we can group the related and similar job under one department. That is, first is functional. Under this method, functional method, the related job, the job which is related to the common function, are grouped under one department. For example, the job related to the production department is related, production function, it's grouped under production departments. The function, the job related to sales department, it's grouped under sales function, is grouped under sales department, and so on. That is clear. Next, that is on the basis of division. Divisional. Under this method, suppose if the firm is producing more than one product, then they are using this method. Under this method, the job related to a particular product, it's grouped under one product. For example, the firm is producing more than one product, like they are producing clothes or textile. They have a textile mill also. They have cosmetics, and they are producing medicines also. So the job related to the cosmetics, it's grouped under cosmetic department. The job related to, that is your medicine, is grouped under medicine department. That is clear. So that is the next step. Now the third step, that I am going to tell you what they have to do. That is, after assignment of duties. Assignment of duties. In this third step, that is the third function that in the organizing process the manager have to perform. After dividing or departmentalization of activities, the employees working in different department, they assign, means to them, the manager have to assign duties matching with their skills and qualification. The working is assigned to them according to their capability. According to their capability, the duties are assigned. That is clear. Next, in that assignment of duties, means the job which is related, the person, those who are able to perform that task, to them we are assigning the duties, so they will carry out their work. Next, the fourth, that is establishing reporting relationship. After dividing the work and departmentalization, and after assignment of duties, the employees, or after the division of work, departmentalization of activity, these employees, they have to perform their work, their job. And for carried out their job, they need some authority. So, in the fourth function, in the fourth step of organizing process, in that the authority is assigned to them, that is matched with their jobs, which is related to their job. The assignment of authority, it creates the superior subordinate relationship also, and the question is clarified in the mind of employees that who is report to whom. Here, in this, the persons, those who are having a higher authority, they are considered as superior, and the person, those who are having less authority, they are considered as subordinate. So it will also create the series of manager, that एंड ऑल्सो एबल टू फॉलो द स्केलर चेन टू हूम दे आर गोइंग टू रिपोर्ट एंड फ्रॉम हूम दे विल गेट द ऑर्डर. इट ऑल्सो डिवाइड द डिफ्रेंशिएट द डिफरेंट लेवल ऑफ मैनेजमेंट. सपोज If the person, the persons, the individual, those who are having higher authority, they are considered as top level managers. The managers, those who are having little less authority, they are considered as middle level. And the manager, those who are having minimum authority, they are considered as lower level manager. So it creates a chain of series of managers and also establish the relationship that to whom you can order and to whom from whom you can receive order. That is clear. Now this is the process. Now I am going to tell you the next topic, that is importance. Importance of organizing. That is clear. So first point that I am going to tell you in importance, that is benefit in that is your benefit in specialization. Benefit in specialization. How it will be beneficial in specialization? As in organizing function, the work is assigned to the individual, not the whole task. A part of whole task is assigned to the employees, not the whole task. So when they are performing their part of task again and again, it leads to specialization. When they are performing their task again and again, automatically it creates the specialization in them and it will beneficial for firm as well as for the employees. That is clear. Next benefit, that is next importance, that is clarity in relationship. And as in organizing function, it clearly defined that what and how much power, authority is enjoyed by different individual in the organizing. It clearly defined that who can give the order, to whom you can give the order, or from whom he has to receive the order. It clarified the reporting relationship in this function. That is clear. Next, I am going to tell you, that is your clarity in relationship, optimum utilization of resources. As there is a less chances of duplication of work, because in organizing, it clearly defined the job. It clearly defined the job of each individual, those who are working in the organization, in the job description document. So it's very less chances or few chances are there that the same work is to be done by two person or more than two person. So there should be an optimum utilization of resource because of this function. That is clear. Next, as in the business environment, the changes take place very frequently. That's, you know it very well. So with the help of organizing function, add in this function, the similar related jobs are grouped under one department. So if the changes will be take place and it affect that particular area, so we will make the changes in that particular area, in that particular department, and after making the changes, it will be communicated to the whole organization, and because of that, the changes can be made systematically in the organization without facing any difficulty. That is clear. Next, that is effective administration. As you know, administration means the plan and policy. According to that, the work should be gone. As in the organizing functions, the work is assigned according to their skills and qualification, and everyone know their job, that what they have to perform. So they are performing according to the plan and performing their activities as per the instruction that is given by the, or as per the duties which is mentioned in the job description document. So it improved the administrative efficiency of the organization, as the everyone they are working their work according to the work assigned to them. That is clear. Next, that is the last importance, that is expansion and growth. Expansion and growth. With the due to this organizing functions, as the departments are divided and the job related to the similar task is grouped under one department, so the changes can meet over in these departments, and it's very easy to expand the business, because if we want to increase the or expand our business, it can be easily expanded, because we have made the systematic organization, we have a systematic working, the similar related jobs are grouped under one department, so it's very easy to meet these changes and expand our business. That is clear to everyone. On the next topic, that is organizational structure. Organizational structure. Organizational structure. That is clear. So before starting this, first of all, I am telling it what is organizational structure. When a manager performing the organizational function, automatically it creates the structure of organization. Structure of organization. That is clear. That define job position of employees, their authority and responsibility. So when the manager is performing this organizing function, it automatically creates the structure of the organization, that structure defines the job position of the employees, their authority and responsibility also. That is clear. The organizational structure, it is a framework within managerial and operational activities activities are performed. That is clear. A framework within managerial and organizational activities are performed, that is to be considered as organizational structure. That establish the relationship between people, human resource, and other resources. One term is there, that is span of management, that give the shape to the structure of the organization, that give the organizational structure shape. That term, span of management. It means how many number of employees are working under one superior. How many subordinates are working under one supervisor? That is clear. That is to be considered as span of management. How many number of employees are working under one superior, that is considered as span of management. If the span of management is effective, more number of management subordinates are there under one manager, it means under one superior, it means the employees are well trained, well qualified, and superior also have faith and trust on their subordinates. If less number, it means the employees are less trained and maybe the superior, they don't have faith on the subordinates. That is clear. Now I am going to tell you the types of organizational structure. As we have discussed about the organizational structure, that it is a framework or it is a network of job position, authority, and responsibility of the employees. So in that, this organization structure can be classified or can be divided in two different structure, in two types of different structure that I am going to tell you. First, that is functional structure. On the basis of feature and factors, we can divide the organization structure into two types, that is functional and divisional. So first of all, I am going to tell you functional structure. Okay. Functional structure, when the job related to one function are grouped under one department, then it is to be considered as functional structure. It means that the job related to the one function are grouped under one department is to be considered as functional structure. For example, the job related to production function, that is grouped under production department. Sales related to the sales function, that is grouped under the sales department. That is clear to everyone. Now I am going to tell what's the, obviously the coin have two faces. If functional structure have some advantage, so some disadvantage also. So I am going to tell you the first advantage of functional structure. First advantage, that is occupational specialization occupational specialization, it means that is, suppose the job related to one function is grouped under one department, and the person, the individual, he is going to perform that departmental activities, that particular function again and again. So he will specialize in it, and specialization it create in the work of the employees. That is clear, and it will be beneficial for the employees as well as organization, because he will perform efficiently and effectively by wasting less resources or no resources. That is clear. Second, promote control and coordination within department. Within department. As there is only one function and it is very easy to supervise or assess the activities of a particular department by the production department head, and it is very easy, better way to control the whole department. That is clear. Next advantage, that is increase managerial and operational efficiency. Increase managerial, as when they are performing their activity again and again, they become specialize in that, their efficiency is improve, it reduce the cost of production, and the less or no wastage of resources is there, and increase the margin of profit. That is clear. Fourth, that is easy and effective controlling. Easy and effective training. Easy and effective training. As the trainer, he has to focus on particular field and provide a training for a particular department. So it's very easy for the trainer to provide training and train the trainee in a well manner. That is clear. Now these are the advantages. So the another, we are going to the another phase of the, that is disadvantage of functional structure. First, place less importance to the overall objective. To overall objective. As every functions, every department, they are performing their activities by giving due importance to their own departmental objective. Many times they are ignoring the overall objective by giving due importance to their own departmental objective. Because of that, the firm is not able to achieve the organizational goal. Second, that is problem of coordination. As why there is a problem of coordination? Because they are not coordinating their activities, because the individual department, they are thinking that they are the priority of other department. They feel that and understand that they are the priority of other department. Means because of their department, the firm is not able to achieve that target. Next, that is inflexibility. Flexibility. Inflexibility, it means flexibility means that is so the employees, they are get training for their own department, they are well trained, they are having a knowledge of about one department and about one function only, and if there will be a situation that some employees should be required in the other departments, so the employees cannot be transferred from one department to another because it incur loss also and wastage of resources also. Fourth, conflict. It create conflict between the departments, among the department, because of their thoughts, as they are not because of their interest. As sales department, they want to increase the sale by offering discount, and finance department, they thought it increase the revenue if they are offering a discount. That is clear. Now the next topic, that is divisional structure. Divisional structure, when the firm organization is producing more than one product, then this divisional structure should be made. Means the job related to a particular one product is to be grouped under one department. That is to be considered. For example, if firm is producing soap, textile, clothes, medicine, so the job related to soap, that is to be placed under one department, soap department, and so on. That is clear. Now, advantage of this department. First advantage, that is product specialization. Product specialization, it means that is all the activities related to the one product are performing again and again. It will arise the integration as well as specialization in the product. Next, fast decision making, as the one department is not depend on other departments, so they take the decision very fastly, as they don't have to depend on other department for taking decision. Next, that is third one. Fast decision clear. Next, that is accountability. Yes, accountability. Accountability means answerable. So if it is very easy to analyze the performance of the department, and because of whose department the firm is not able to achieve the common or organization goal. Fourth, that is expansion and growth. If the firm organization want to introduce a new product, they can produce without disturbing the other department. That is clear. Now I am going to tell the disadvantage. First, that is conflict. As why conflict is to be there? Because it's very difficult to distribute the resources, how the resources are to be distributed among different department. Means to which department the organization is giving more the resources and to which department giving less. Next, that is more resources required, as all the department, they required all type of resources that incur the cost of production and incur much expenses, and the firm organization, they required more type of resources for fulfilling their needs. Next, that is increase in cost of production. As all the department, they require a same type of function. Production function is also required by cosmetic, soap, textile. So the firm have to bear more expenses for fulfilling a same on the same type of function. That is clear to everyone. So these are the disadvantages of the divisional structure. Clear? Now the next topic, that is formal and informal organizational structure. Informal organizational structure. Formal and informal organizational structure. So first of all, I'm going to make you formal organizational structure. Formal organizational structure, it means when the organizing process is to be performed by the manager, automatically it create the organizational structure. And this organizational structure is to be created for achievement, for achieving systematic working and efficient utilization of the organization. For achieving systematic working in the organization and efficient utilization of resources in the organization, for that this organization exists. And it exists while we are performing this organizing process. It is a result of organizing process. In formal organizational structure, it define the job position of the employee, their destination, their designation, their authority, their responsibility, what work they have, and also establish a superior subordinate relationship with the help of this formal structure. That is clear. Now I'm going to go with the advantage and disadvantage of these type of organization. First advantage of formal organizational structure, that is systematic working. Because of formal organizational structure, due to establishment of formal structure, organizational structure, the work is to be done systematically in the organization. That is the first advantage of this type of structure. Next, that is achievement of organizational goal. Achievement of organizational goal. It means the formal organizational structure, it is to be established for achieving the organizational goal of the firm. That is clear. Next advantage, that is no overlapping of work. As in this formal organizational structure, the work is divided very systematic way. It will define the all the job position, their responsibility, their authority very clearly. So there is no chances of duplication and overlapping of work. That is the third advantage of that this structure. Next, coordination. By establishing formal organizational structure, the departments, these are coordinating their activity with each other. That is clear. Now I am going to tell you the disadvantage of the formal organizational structure. Disadvantage. First is delay in action. Yes, as you know, in the formal organization, the manager have to go through, communicate any of the information in the organization by following a long scalar chain. So it will get the command of action get delayed just because of following this whole scalar chain and inform the things. That is clear. Next, that is ignoring सोशल नीड्स एंड सोशल एंड साइकोलॉजिकल नीड्स, साइकोलॉजिकल नीड्स. एज इन दिस टाइप ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल स्ट्रक्चर, फॉर्मल ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल स्ट्रक्चर, दे आर गिविंग ड्यू इंपॉर्टेंस टू द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑब्जेक्टिव, ऑर्गेनाइजेशन नीड. दे आर इग्नोरिंग द सोशल एंड साइकोलॉजिकल नीड्स ऑफ द एम्प्लॉयज एंड इट विल डीमोटिवेट द एम्प्लॉयज टू पुट देयर बेस्ट. लास्ट दैट इज इग्नोरिंग सोशल नीड्स, सोशल एंड साइकोलॉजिकल डिले इन एक्शन, एम्फेसिस ऑफ वर्क ओनली. मीन्स इन दैट टाइप ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन द मेन फोकस ओनली ऑन वर्क. They are ignoring, they are not focusing on the for maintaining a good relation, a familiar relation, a friend relation, a social needs. They are not going to focus on that. They are ignoring that. That is clear to everyone. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of this organizational, formal organizational structure. That is clear. Next that I am going to tell you, that is informal organizational structure. Informal organizational structure, as in the formal organizational structure, the employees, they are working on various job position, and while they are performing, they are working in this job position, they are interacting with each other and develop a social and friendly relation in the organization. This process of social and friend relation in the organization, it create the another structure of the organization, and that is known as informal organizational structure. That is known as informal organizational structure. That is clear to everyone. Now, in that informal organizational structure, it is to be created automatically. While the as the functional structure, sorry, formal organizational structure have created, automatically it create the, that is your informal. As in the formal, the people are working at different job position, at various job position, and while working, they are interacting to each other and developing these needs. So because of that, automatically it create the informal organizational structure. It will fulfill fulfill the psychological social needs. It create a healthier relation among the people, and employees are also motivated to put their best efforts. Now I am going to tell you advantage of this structure. First, that is fast communication. Informal organizational structure, as the people are friendly, they are communicating friendly and establishing a social relationship. With the help of this, the people can communicate to each other very frequently, very fastly. If any information is to be passed, we can pass fastly with each of them in the organization with this structure. Next, that is fulfilling social needs. Social needs. As due to the establishment of informal organizational structure, it fulfills the psychological needs of the employees, social and psychological needs of the employees, and the people, they get motivated and put their best efforts for achieving the goal. Correct feedback, that is the next. If the top level, they want to get to know the right or correct feedback of the employees, those who are working in the organization, so they can get it by communicating friendly with them, and they are getting the correct feedback on the different plan and policy which is going in the organization. That is clear. Now I am going to tell some disadvantage of इनफॉर्मल ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल स्ट्रक्चर, इनफॉर्मल ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल स्ट्रक्चर दैट इज डिसएडवांटेज. डिसएडवांटेज फर्स्ट दैट इज स्प्रेड र्यूमर. Most of the time we have seen that in that type of structure, mostly rumors have spread very, means the things which is spread very fastly, that was rumor, and it create confusion in the mind of employees. Next, that is no systematic working. Under this type of structure, the working is not going in a systematic way, as people are connecting in friendly way in us for fulfilling their social needs. Third, that I am going to tell you, that is no system may bring negative result. Suppose if any information, wrong information passed to the employees in the organization, it may mislead the employees and also make, if that information is gathered by the employees in another way, it will also create problem for the organization as well as employees. That is clear. It mislead the employee and they will not put their best efforts. That is clear to everyone. Okay, now I am going to tell you the next topic, that is delegation. Before starting the definition, firstly I am going to write the definition, then I am going to make you understand this process. So before starting it, firstly I am going to make you understand in this. As you know, in the organization, manager are assigned lots of work, and alone individually he cannot perform the whole task. So for that, the manager, he divide the work among the employees, those who are working under him, and he will divide the work according to their qualifications and skills. So in the beginning, the manager start with by sharing, by passing some of his responsibility to the subordinate, and to carry out this these responsibility by the and get the work done, and to carry out this these responsibility, he has to also pass some of his authority to the subordinate, so they can carry out that work in a systematic way, in an expected manner. That is clear. And after, while passing responsibility and authority, he should also create accountability to make sure that the work should be carried out in an expected manner. He is also creating accountability for the non-completion of task. This whole process is known as delegation. Now I am going to tell you the definition of this. It is a process in which the manager entrusting responsibility and authority and also create accountability to the employees who are entrusted responsibility and authority. That is clear. That is the definition. And in simple word, I can say that transfer of authority and responsibility from सुपीरियर टू सबऑर्डिनेट्स, टू सबऑर्डिनेट्स, दैट इज क्लियर टू एवरीवन। सो इट इज अ प्रोसेस, द मैनेजर entrusted the responsibility and authority and also created accountability to the employees who are entrusted this responsibility and authority. And in simple word, we can say that transfer of authority and responsibility from superior to subordinate is to be considered as, it is the process of delegation. That is clear to everyone? Clear? Okay. Now, I am going to tell you something like principle of absoluteness of accountability, principle of absoluteness of accountability. Now listen it carefully. As delegation, it is a process for carrying out the activities systematically in the organization. But it is not the process of abdication, which means accountability cannot be delegated. Yes, the authority and the manager, after creating accountability on the subordinates, to the subordinates, manager is also accountable, answerable for non-completion of tasks, same as the subordinates are answerable. For example, suppose if sales manager, he assigned a work for selling 1,000 units in a month. So this sale manager, he has divided this work among the subordinate, those who are working under him, among the 5 employees. And one at the end of month, only 800 units have sold, just because one salesman fall sick, and due to that, only 800 units have sold at the end of month. But for the non-completion of task or for not achieving the objective, manager is also liable or accountable, answerable for not selling 1,000 units in a month. Because after passing responsibility and authority and creating accountability, manager is also analyze time to time. The manager, he also check time to time the work, the task is going according to his instruction or not, and he is also, and if the task hasn't completed on time, he is also answerable for the same. That is principle of absoluteness accountability. Now I am going to tell you, that is elements of delegation, or you can say process of delegation. ठीक है, द फर्स्ट एलिमेंट दैट इज रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी. इन दैट इट मीन्स असाइनमेंट ऑफ वर्क टू द इंडिविजुअल, असाइनमेंट ऑफ वर्क टू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक दैट इज एलिमेंट्स ऑफ डेलीगेशन प्रोसेस, और यू कैन से दैट प्रोसेस ऑफ डेलीगेशन. In that, the first element, that is responsibility. Responsibility means assigning of work to the individual. It includes all the physical and mental activities which each and every employees to whom the manager have given this assigning that duty, he has to perform. Manager, he is passing some of his responsibility to the subordinate and they have to carry out that responsibility. So according to that, we can say that responsibility can be passed or delegated. That is clear to everyone. Next, that is authority. Authority, next element, that is authority. Authority means power to take decision. Power to take decision. In that, power to take decision. In that, as to carry out the activity or the responsibility which has been given by the manager, which has been given by the manager, there is a need by the subordinates some authority. So in that, manager is, while after passing the responsibility, he has to pass some authority to carry out the work in a systematic way in the organization and to get the work done. That is clear. But while he is passing the authority, the manager should keep in mind that whatever the authority he is passing or delegating, it should match with the responsibility which he has given to their employees. That is clear. So according to that, authority can also be passed or delegated. Third, that is accountability. Accountability. Accountability as to make sure that the responsibility can be carried out in an expected manner, accountability is created. Accountability means answerable for non-completion of tasks. But accountability cannot be delegated or passed. The manager also accountable for the remain the same for non-completion of tasks. So it cannot be delegated or passed. So for getting the work in a systematic way, in an expected manner, the manager is creating to the subordinates accountability. That is clear. For example, that example I have given, and one more example I am giving, that production manager, he has got to produce 100 units within 3 days. He is dividing that work with among his 10 employees, those who are working under him. Suppose 2 employees were remain absent, and because of that the task haven't completed. So for non-completion of tasks, as the subordinates are answerable, same this production manager is also answerable, as he haven't go through with the operation production process, he hasn't checked time to time the work should go on according to the instruction that he has given or not, and he hasn't taken any corrective measure for it. That is clear. Yes. Now the next topic, that is importance of delegation. First, that is effective management. As in the delegation, manager is going to pass his routine job to their subordinate. He has passed the routine job to subordinates, and it will reduce his burden and free from that burden, and after that he can concentrate on the important matters and also get the work done through others. By delegating his authority and responsibility to the subordinate, he can get the work done by their subordinates efficiently and effectively, and improve the management efficiency. That is clear. Next, that is employees development. Employees development. Employees development, in that, in delegation, the manager provide the opportunities to the employees to improve, to use their skills, talent, and by delegating the authority and responsibility, they will get the opportunity to perform the complex tasks. They will get the opportunity to perform the complex task. As by delegating the authority and responsibility, the subordinate, they will get the opportunity while doing the work at as a subordinate, they will get the opportunity to perform the activity of higher position, higher job. It will improve, it will develop their skills, so it will be workable in future. That is clear. Next, that is motivation of employees. Motivation of employees. As in the delegation, superior, he is going to delegate his responsibility and authority to the subordinate. So because of that, the employees, they get motivated as they feel the belongingness and trust of their superior on them, and they will perform in a well manner, in an expected manner, and put their best efforts for the achievement of goal. That is clear. Many companies and many employees are there which is to be motivated by this technique used by the managers, that is to be considered as non-financial incentives. That is clear, to motivate the employees. Next, that is your 4th one, facilitate organizational growth. Facilitate organizational growth. How it facilitate the organizational growth? As in the delegation, manager, he is going to pass, is going to delegate his authority and responsibility, as in the delegation, he is passing his responsibility and authority to the subordinate by keeping in mind their qualification, their capability. This lead to division of work. Now everyone, they will get their work, and while they are doing again and again, they will get specialized in it, and this specialization can be utilized for the betterment or the expansion of organizational growth. That is clear to everyone. Next, that is 5th one, better coordination. How better coordination can exist? In delegation, the authority and responsibility can be delegated to the subordinate, and also they are answerable for the non-completion of tasks. This process is clear the picture of everyone of their work. So there will be no duplication of work, and because of that, it brings the coordination in their activity in the organization. That is clear to everyone. Next, I am going to tell you, that is the last one. After better coordination, effective management is clear, employment development is clear, motivation of employees also clear, facilitate with better coordination, and last, that is your last बेसिस फॉर मैनेजर एच मैनेजर सीरीज. हाउ इट बिकम? बिकॉज इन डेलीगेशन इट एस्टैब्लिश अ सुपीरियर सबऑर्डिनेट रिलेशनशिप. एस्टैब्लिश अ सुपीरियर सबऑर्डिनेट रिलेशनशिप एंड इट इज द एक्सटेंशन ऑफ मैनेजर सीरीज. विद द डेलीगेशन इट विल गिव द पावर एंड अथॉरिटी टू द डिफरेंट लेवल ऑफ मैनेजर एंड क्रिएट द सीरीज ऑफ एंड गिव द बेस फॉर क्रिएटिंग मैनेजर हैची. क्रिएटिंग मैनेजर सीरीज ऑफ चेन ऑफ मैनेजर्स. दैट इज क्लियर टू एवरी वन. दीज आर द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ योर डेलीगेशन. नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक, दैट इज सेंट्रलाइजेशन एंड डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन. सेंट्रलाइजेशन एंड डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन इट मीन्स, सेंट्रलाइजेशन मीन्स पावर इन द हैंड ऑफ फ्यू पीपल, दैट इज इन द हैंड ऑफ टॉप लेवल ओनली. मीन्स टॉप लेवल ओनली आर देयर टू टेक ईच एंड एवरी डिसीजन. दैट इज अ सेंट्रलाइजेशन पॉलिसी. डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन द पावर डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन मीन्स अ सिस्टमैटिक डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ अथॉरिटी एट एवरी लेवल ऑफ मैनेजर. इन डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन every level of manager they will get some authority to carry out their responsibility to take some decision in the organization. As you know, decentralization it is a policy matter, so manager they should decide in advance that what policy should be taken in the organization, centralization or decentralization. Some companies, some firm, most of the firm, what they are doing, they are taking a combination of both centralization as well as decentralization. For example, such as that is structural decision, financial decision should be taken by the top level and the common decision should be taken by the middle level and lower level. That is clear to everyone. So it is depend upon the top level. After that also many firm, some firms are there, they are going through with the little or no decentralization in their organizations. That is clear to everyone. Now I am going to tell you the relationship between delegation and decentralization. First point, that is decentralization is the extension of delegation. How? Because in delegation we multiply the authority with two people, and in decentralization we multiply the authority with many. Because a systematic delegation that will take at every place, at every level of organization, and evenly a systematic distribution of authority at every level of manager result in decentralization. But if delegation is restricted to certain level, so there will be no complete decentralization. That is clear. For example, suppose a managing director, he is going to assign a work, a task to production head, production department head, to produce 50,000 units. Production department is going to share the and also give responsibility this and also give managing director also give the authority to purchase the raw material machinery which is required to produce that much of unit, and also provide give the authority to select the employees for carrying out the work. Production department head, he is going to share this authority and responsibility with production manager to and also give the responsibility to carry out this 50,000 unit in a year, and also give the authority to select the worker to pay and also decided their salary. Production manager, he is going to share this task with supervisor share this authority and responsibility with foreman, and he is going to share his authority and responsibility with machine operator. The whole process at the division of systematic division of authority from managing director to machine operator is considered as decentralization. Centralization. That is clear. And this managing director to production head to production manager, production to supervisor, supervisor to foreman, or foreman to this, all called delegation. When the authority is divided between two people, that delegation. When it is divided in many, then it is decentralization. That is clear to everyone. Now, the next relation between delegation and decentralization. That is your second point. Delegation is necessary, but decentralization is not. Delegation is necessary, but decentralization is not. That is clear. Why delegation is necessary and decentralization not? Because I'm going delegation, that is a very important element, important part of every organization. Without the concept of delegation, no firm can work carried out their work efficiently and effectively. The reason behind it, because an individual person are not able to perform all the activities of the organization in a well manner. So because of that, there is a need to divide the work that will reduce the burden of managers, top level managers, and they can concentrate on the that is your main work. But decentralization, it is not necessary. It depends upon the top level management. If the top level cannot manage the activity in a well manner, then especially they can go through with the policy, they can divide the authority at every level of management. But if it is possible to handle all the situation by top level, then they should go with the delegation. But delegation is important in each and every organization for carried out their work efficiently and effectively. That is clear. Next, I am going to tell you the importance of delegation. Importance of decentralization. The last topic and the chapter is going to finish. Importance. The first importance, that is develop initiative among employees. The first importance of delegation is that while decentralization is that developing the initiative among employees. While distributing the authority and responsibility at every level of management, it will they will motivate and put their best efforts because it will show the faith and trust of their superior on them, on the subordinates, and they are free to take the decision without taking permission from the top level in common matter or in the or performing a carried out the routine job. Next, that is develop talent for future. Develop the talent of employees for future. As in decentralization, the authority and responsibility are distributed by the top level management at middle level and lower level. So middle level and lower level, they will get the opportunity to do the complex tasks efficiently and effectively. While they are working at their own level, that is middle, they will get the opportunity to perform the activities of the top level. It will improve, it will develop their skills for performing the task of the top level management. So whenever any vacancy will be there in the any vacant job position in there in the organization in top level management, they will, because of their experience, because of their skills, they can be promoted at that post, and it will be beneficial for organization as well as for the employees. That is clear. Next, importance, that is quick decision making. Under this quick decision making, as the authority and responsibility has got by the middle level and lower level, so for performing carried out their activities, there is no need to take permission from the top level for carried out the routine activities. The decision should take very fastly without taking permission, and whenever the quick decision is required for performing at every level of major activities, they can take the decision in a right way. That is clear. Next, that is quick decision making, that is now relief to top level management. As top level managers, they are going to distribute the authority and responsibility among the among the middle level and lower level. It will reduce their burden, and they are free from the activities, and they can concentrate free from the burden, and they can concentrate on the important matter rather than the routine job which they have done earlier before using that decentralization process. That is clear to everyone. Last, that is fifth one, facilitate growth. In decentralization, the employees get the freedom to take decision for carried out their activities in that manner which is best suited to them. When every department, they will put their best for increasing the productivity of the firm or of their own department, it will increase the revenue of the firm, and that increase in the revenue which has increased, it should be utilized for the expansion of the firm, and it facilitates the growth of the company. That is clear to everyone. The chapter have finished.